So my presentation is going to be about the subjective effects of holotropic breathwork and psychedelics, comparing both of them. So first of all, I want to talk a little bit about transpersonal psychology, because transpersonal psychology was the first school of psychology which started studying the spiritual dimension of human nature and also the non-ordinary state of consciousness. So I think it's important to address that information. And transpersonal psychology was founded in 1968 by a group of psychologists who wanted to expand the framework of psychology beyond its focus on the individual self. So, also transpersonal psychology has been interested in the study of mystical experiences since the beginning of his existence. So, different authors have been studying this dimension, the mystical experience, because inside the transpersonal experiences we have a lot of different experiences, and a mystical experience is a subgroup of experiences inside all the transpersonal experiences, but we are not going to address all these other experiences. So, even though transpersonal psychology was founded in the 60s, before that there were some pioneers, including Richard Buck, William James, Carl Gustav Jung, Asaki Oli. There were some authors who were talking about this spirituality, non-ordinary state of consciousness in psychology during the 20th century, the first decades of the 20th century. So it's not so new, the interest of this stage and spirituality inside psychology. So among the founders we can find Abraham Maslow and also Stan Grof. So I'm going to focus more in Stan Grof because he's the founder. One of the founders of the transpersonal psychology. He was also doing psychedelic research for almost 20 years during the 50s, 60s and 70s, and then he was also the creator of holotropic breathwork. So Cameron has been explaining a little bit this. So basically, when we talk about the psychedelic experience or about altered states of consciousness, we are not talking about psychedelics only. You can reach this state using different techniques. So basically, what transpersonal psychology is talking about when it talks about altered states of consciousness, focusing in this talk, is that the mystical experiences and other transpersonal experiences can be induced using a number of different techniques and also spontaneously, because there is people who has these experiences without the use of any technique. So transpersonal psychology considered that using these techniques we can access to the so-called altered states of consciousness. So I have done these small graphics. You have the different techniques that can include the psychedelics, the breathing, fasting, chanting, different techniques. You access these altered states of consciousness where a lot of things can happen, and inside the, all the things that can happen during this altered state of consciousness, we have all the transpersonal experiences and the mystical experience. Okay? So, to talk about altered states of consciousness is difficult, so different authors has been using different names to talk about this. Also, they has been named like non-ordinary state of consciousness, expanded state of consciousness, holotropic states, because we are talking about a dimension which is not very material, so it's very difficult to define it and put words in these states. So again, we have different techniques to access this state. So we have meditation, fasting, chanting, dancing, music, breathing in different rhythms. Holotropic breathwork is one of them. Psychedelics, also spontaneously. So we have a very wide range of techniques. So the research on mystical experiences also has been done before transpersonal psychology start working on this realm. So different authors study the mystical experiences using different methods and methodology and proposing different criteria and characteristics to define it. So William James studied more than 100 years ago, Evelyn Underhill, and other authors. So I'm going to focus in those three a little bit. The first of them is Walter Stays. He made a phenomenological study of the mystical experiences, making a content analysis of the literature about mystical experiences, taking like Eastern philosophy and mysticism, and also Western mysticism. So taking all these accounts and literature about mystical experiences, he describes the main characteristics of what is the mystical experience. So another author which was studying this in an indirect way was Abraham Maslow, because he studied the peak experiences. I'm not going to go deep on that, but he started studying people who in the Western culture has this stage, and he mentioned different characteristics of this stage, and he named them peak experiences on purpose not to link them with the mysticism and spirituality, because he wanted to make a separation between the both realms. So then, Walter Panky, I don't know if you know about it, he was a psychedelic researcher in the 60s. He made this very famous experiment, the Good Friday experiment, and he developed one questionnaire called Peak Experience Profile. So, bueno, we have been talking about psychedelic psychotherapy during all this conference, so I'm not going to stop here, but you know that there is the psycholytic psychotherapy. It was developed more in Europe. Then there is the psychedelic psychotherapy. It was developed in the States. And basically, the focus of the psychedelic psychotherapy was precisely in the mystical type transformative experiences that people can have if you give them high doses of LSD and other psychedelics. So there is this big link between psychedelic psychotherapy, transpersonal psychology, and mystical experiences. So also the psychedelic psychotherapy give a lot of relevance to the setting of the experience, the context. Well, there are a number of authors who were working in this area, but we are going to focus on Walter Panky. He made this experiment precisely to see if it's true that you can induce mystical experiences using psychedelics. This was in the 60s. So, because he was looking for the mystical experiences, he made this experiment, because it was an experiment, in a chapel in Boston. He was doing his PhD dissertation, and he was studying precisely the occurrence of mystical experiences, and he developed this questionnaire, the Peak Experience Profile, which is the questionnaire that I'm going to use, and I'm going to present the results of my studies. So I'm going to present this briefly, because I'm going to compare later on the results of Panky with other research that has been done afterwards and with my data. So the aim of Panky was basically to measure and evaluate the potential mystical experiences occasioned by psilocybin. She was basing on the classic descriptive work of mystical experiences by Walter Stays, this author that I mentioned before. So Walter Stays covered the main dimensions of the mystical experiences. Panky covers the main dimensions of the mystical experiences which Stays describes. So I'm going to mention a little bit the main results. Walter Panky found that the 40% of the volunteers of his study who received psilocybin experiences the phenomenon characterizes as mystical experience. So what means that? Well, these are the main characteristics of the mystical experiences according to Stays and this questionnaire. You can read them. It's unity, both external or internal, transcendence of time and space, ineffability and paradoxicality, sense of sacredness, objectivity and reality, deeply feel positive mood, and transiency. I'm not going to stop now to explain this, maybe later if you have time, but you can see a little bit what are the main characteristics here, so I'm going to now link it with the results. So this questionnaire is basically a 100-item questionnaire. The original version has 7 scales, which are basically these ones. So the score of each scale is expressed, has a proportion of the maximum possible score. And the maximum possible score in the original version was 100. In the new versions is 1. I'm going to explain this later on also. So the criteria for having had a complete mystical experience was that the scores of time in each of the scales have to be at least 60. So you need to score above 60% in each of the categories, which was a pretty high score, taking into account that we are talking about sense of unity, transcendence of time and space, ineffability, sense of sacredness, and so on. So these are the results of Panky. So this is in the 63. He find that it was a control group, so 10 people of this study take psilocybin in the context of this in this chapel, in the context of a like mass. So they created all the environment of a mass to make this experiment. So 4 of the 10 participants had mystical experiences according to the criteria of this questionnaire. This is the 40% of the 10 subjects. None of the control group has this kind of experiences, and you can see the differences are pretty big. So, and also if you make the analysis, he found that there were significant differences between both groups. So this was in the 63. Then the original version of the big experience profile has been modified and expanded over the years. Walter Panky itself modified it. William Richards and other psychedelic researchers, Stan Grove itself, Richard Jensen, they were making some change during the 70s and 80s. And then in the 2000 or 2001, they changed the name of the questionnaire. They named it States of Consciousness Questionnaire. This version was developed by Ronald Griffiths, but also William Richard was involved in the development of this new version to conduct a number of studies again. Using in this case also a double-blind and placebo-controlled methodology. So basically they were replicating Panky study of the 60s like 15 years ago. So this was one of the first studies with psychedelics that has been done after the 30 years of prohibition. So again, the State of Consciousness questionnaire, it has 100 items. In this case, it has 6 scales instead of 7. They take off 1. They maintain almost the same, is unity, transcendence of time and space, ineffability, sacrality, noetic quality, deeply felt, positive mood. And in this case, the score of each scale are expressed has a proportion of the maximum possible score fixed in 1, not in 100. When we are going to see the results, you are going to see that the maximum is 1 in this case. And again, the criteria for having had a complete mystical experience is that the score obtained in each of the scales had to be at least 0.6 in this case, but this again the 60% of the maximum score. So, well, this is in the 60s where they were doing psychedelic psychotherapy in Baltimore, Stan Grove and his team, and all this building that you can see behind is where they were doing the psychedelic psychotherapy in this time. This is Albert Hofmann. So then, as I told you, it was this prohibition for several years, almost 3 decades, then again, the research project started again. Now we are living a psychedelic renaissance with a lot of projects with different psychedelics. So the John Hopkins study was one of the first studies after all these years of prohibition. They made this double-blind study evaluating the short and medium-term effects of a high dose of psilocybin. So the results here, they were like, they find that psilocybin occasioned mystical experiences in 71 of the volunteers that participated in the study when they give them the high dose of psilocybin. This was 22 of 36 subjects. And then they look at the persistent effects of these mystical experiences. So they found that at 2 and 14 months, the volunteers considered the experience has very significant both personally and spiritually. And they also attributed to the experience sustained positive change in their attitude and behavior. So not only they have the mystical experiences, but they also attribute very significant value to this experience in their lives. So this was what I found when I was starting to do this research on holotropic breathwork. Well, this is William Richards presenting the data of these studies in the International Transpersonal Conference in Moscow 2010. This is the setting they use for the psychedelic psychotherapy with psilocybin. And then they make this dose effect study where they give different doses of psilocybin, and very interestingly, they found that the percentage of people and volunteers who have mystical experiences was increasing according to the dose. So when they give very low doses, they have only 5.6% of the volunteers having mystical experiences. With a medium dose, it was 11%, and with a medium high dose, it was between 44 and 55% of the volunteers. And this was also also coherent with the previous research that they have done. But now they found that the dose, increasing the dose, you have more mystical experiences. And this was pretty interesting also. Well, this is the dose effect results, but just to see that the percentage of the people who has mystical experiences increase. Well, this is the framework. So as I tell you, Stan Grove, he was working with psychedelic psychotherapy for 20 years. Then he founded the transpersonal psychology in the 60s. Then he developed the holotropic breathwork when psychedelic psychotherapy was prohibited for so many years. So he developed the holotropic breathwork, which basically is originally a hyperventilation technique, but it's not exactly a hyperventilation technique, but I don't have time to address that now, but it involves more elements. It involves a number of diverse elements, including the breathing, but also evocative music and elective body work. The context was based on the psychedelic research Stan Grove was doing before, so it's very similar context and philosophy also. The sessions of holotropic breathwork last between 2, 2.5, or 3 hours, and usually are made in groups. So Stan Grove claims that holotropic breathwork can occasion also transpersonal experiences and specifically mystical experiences, but he never did any research to prove that. So he also claims that all the spectrum of transpersonal experiences that can be induced with psychedelics can be also induced with holotropic breathwork. These are the claims of Stan Grove. So I started looking to that. So my first question was if the holotropic breathwork can occasion mystical experiences. So I made a research on the subjective effects of holotropic breathwork and specifically exploring the occurrence of the mystical experiences. Then I also was looking if the context was important, because Stan Grove talked about the importance of the context. So I made different research about the subjective effects in different contexts where holotropic breathwork is used, because holotropic breathwork can be used in one-day workshops, in weekend workshops, in week-long workshops, so there are different kind of settings. And then I also address and I also look at that if it's possible to compare the subjective effects of occasioned by holotropic breathwork and different psychedelics. So I was doing some research on the subjective effects of different psychedelics, including ayahuasca. I also have this data from psilocybin, so I use them to compare with holotropic breathwork. And then with some underground psychedelic psychotherapist, I have also some data from LSD psychotherapy. So I'm going to try to explain a little bit, not all of them, but a part of these results. So addressing the holotropic breathwork research, I made like four different research in four different contexts. Well, in fact, they were three different contexts. The first one was in a week-long residential workshop near New York. And the sample was young adults. Bueno, I'm not going to address that a lot, but then I replicated this study again 2 years later, and then I made the same in a day-long workshop in Russia, in Moscow, and then I made the same in Spain in a weekend residential workshop. So I have like different contexts, and also the first samples are from the States, the second is from Russia, the third is from Russia, the last one is from Spain. So what I found basically is that in this first case, holotropic breathwork occasioned mystical experiences in 6 participants of the 29 of the participants of the workshop who filled out the questionnaires. This is the 20.7% of the participants who filled out the questionnaire that I was using, which was this state of consciousness questionnaire. So, in fact, because I was looking only to the people aged between 18 and 35, there were around 40 people in this age in the workshop, so it was the most of the people who was in this age, the ones who filled out the questionnaire, but in the workshop there were 140 people. So I can't say that this is representative from all the group, but still it's interesting that to see that holotropic breathwork can occasion also this kind of mystical experiences in this context. So this is the context where the holotropic breathwork was done. So the people lie down, they put a sheet, and also there is the music in the room. There is another person taking care of them, and there are the facilitators in the room. So this is a very safe context. This is the environment, so I think also I put this picture because I think it's important, the environment where the experience take place. Well, these are the means of the group. So they have like a medium intensity experience if we take in account all the group. If we take in account the complete peak experiences, we can see here we have 20%, Punky found 40%, Griffiths found 61%, so it's a lower percentage than with psilocybin, but still we have some people having these kind of experiences during holotropic breathwork. So I replicate this study 2 years later in the same context. In this case, because it was a week-long workshop, they do 2 holotropic breathwork sessions each person. So I took the data from the 2 holotropic breathwork sessions that each participant has during this workshop. So for the first holotropic breathwork, 37 participants complete the questionnaire, 3 has mystical experiences, which is the 8.1% of the volunteers who participate in the study. After the second holotropic breathwork, another 4 people has these mystical experiences, which is the 13.8% of the participants. So again, this is the average score. It's interesting that the deeply feel positive mood subscale is the one who has the higher score. So this is interesting also. This is after the second breathwork. Again, here we can see what I found in the first study. This is the second study after the first breathwork, after the second. So we have between 88% in the less case, 20% in the higher case of people having mystical experiences. So then I made this third study. It was in Moscow, and this was in a day-long workshop. So I was expecting to find less mystical experiences because in a day-long workshop, you don't have such a context that we have seen in the previous study, because it's just one day. It was made in a conference like this, in a big room of the conference. So more than 100 people were, more than 300 people were taking part in this breathwork. So it was a really big breathwork. So it was good because I was able to have 134 people answering to my questionnaire, the state of consciousness questionnaire. And in this case, I found that 13 volunteers of the 134 has mystical experiences during the day-long workshop, which is the 9.7% of the people who fill out the questionnaire. I was surprised because I was expecting to find less people having these experiences in a day-long workshop where the context is not so special, so to say, and in such a big group, so it was surprising for me. And again, the average scores are very similar in each cases, and also the deeply feel positive mood dimension is the higher score in all of them, which is interesting. So then I decided to compare my data with the psilocybin data. So what I found is that the percentage of people having mystical experiences in my study, my studies, and particularly in this fifth study, was similar to the percentage of mystical experiences that people has when they take 10 milligrams per 7 kilograms of psilocybin in the John Hopkins studies. So it's like, because I also find that the average scores of the people doing holotropic breathwork of different groups in different contexts are usually very similar. So it's interesting that if we compare these scores with the psilocybin study scores, we can see that they match pretty well both the subdimensions, average scores,